from Studio 13 in California. You're listening to Wildcard with your hosts, John.
Why couldn't Liam Neeson's daughter stay the fuck home? I mean, it's like nine yeah. takens.
And Connor.
If you have an old fat dude fetish, the nude beach is your paradise.
A show with a lot of stories and an occasional funny one.
Hello and welcome to this episode of Wildcard. On the show today, we welcome Hollywood writer and the co-creator of Comedy Central's Workaholics. We go behind the scenes and learn what it's like to turn an idea into a successful comedy show. Quick side note here, Connor and our guest actually sound a lot alike, so if you can't tell them apart, it's not just you. We also learn what the woke chicks are doing these days for attention. And lastly, if you're gonna order a pervy book from Amazon, don't buy the used copy. Get your hand sanitizer ready. It's another episode of Wildcard. We've got a pretty good one on tap today. Lots of things to cover. We've got a guest today, a famous guest, I guess a behind the scenes famous guest, a writer, TV, I've been told to use the term creator, which I guess means something, but
he's an artist.
An artist, yes.
He's way famouser than us.
When did all the people that were successful, like actors and musicians and everything, all of a sudden want to be called artists? Because I feel like artists are kind of the least successful of that group.
I don't know. I mean, once Subway started calling their sandwich makers artists, I feel like the bar got pretty low.
They shit on everybody. Yeah, they ruined the word.
That voice you're hearing is Dominic Russo. Dominic, thanks for joining us today. As I said, you're a super fancy Hollywood type. Although you
As you
do,
can see by my garage.
Yes, nothing says I'm crushing it in Hollywood like a can of Roundup behind you.
You know how many guys don't have garages in Hollywood?
That's true. Those are not cheap.
People in the Midwest are like, you're poor. Little do you know, that's like a $2 million garage.
We should probably give Dominic's curricula vitae, shouldn't we?
Well, we should, but as we do on the show, we like to make people wait uncomfortably for our interviews, which are the best part of our show.
Yeah.
So before we tap into Dominic and all the glory that is his Hollywood career, I wanted to kind of touch base on a few things. We got some housekeeping, and I've noticed that I kind of start all of the shows with a medical checkup, and I can't leave. Do we have an update? Are you cured?
I go in a couple weeks ago to get the psoriasis treated. They give me a jug of what I have jokingly been calling body mayonnaise, but it turns out that description is pretty accurate because it apparently clogs the dickens out of your pores and gives you horrible acne.
So basically you're replacing the herpetic looking psoriasis sores with full body acne.
Just regular old acne, like old fashioned acne.
Is your body trying to expel something?
Me, it's trying to expel me.
What's left of his soul is trying desperately to get out of its body.
It's all out of your skin.
I just have this conveyor belt of weird disorders. So when I went to the doctor, and one of the things she told me was that sunlight actually helps the psoriasis. So I go down to the fancy nude beach and
nude.
Well, yeah. I mean, I was hoping this would cure the psoriasis. So
we got a nude beach down here.
Oh, it's nice.
Everything as a guy that involves nudity, you think these things are going to be great. These vacations that are like where they have compounds where people are swingers, and you're like, yeah. And then you show up, and
hedonism.
It's just a bunch of people playing frisbee nude.
Mm-hmm.
And with men, most sporting events are something that I think would not be a good look for nudity. When you went to the nude beach, was there activities, yoga?
I mean, paddle tennis.
Yes.
If you have an old fat dude fetish, the nude beach is your paradise. I don't. I was mostly just there to resolve a medical complaint. So I was naked to the world, mooning the sun, and the sun fought back because I basically now look like I sat on a George Foreman. I don't know if you've ever actually been sunburnt on your butt. But it really impacts your day.
Do you have grill marks?
Oh, yeah. No, serious sun grill marks. And just like every time you sit down, you know when you sit in like a pleather seat and your skin kind of sticks to it?
Yeah.
That process is now like being skinned alive. So each medical ailment has sort of launched into another with increasing embarrassment and red marks.
I'm going to need to get some sort of button that is just you're fucking gross.
Yeah.
Because you're just a medley of disgusting every time we start the show. I hope people don't listen to this during breakfast.
I need one of those, you know, the like, hi, my name is stickers. I need one of those that's just like, today's skin disorder is full body acne and butt George Foreman burn.
I like that the medical, you know, suggestion is to burn off your skin. That's what she kind of told you. Go to the sun and just burn off the top couple layers.
You have to understand something, Dominic. Dermatologists don't know anything. They have like two options. They have a cortisone cream and lotion, and the third option is sun.
She gave me both.
No matter what you come in with, they say, here, put this cream on it. If that doesn't work, sunburn it.
Yeah. John won't get this reference, Dominic, because he's never watched a movie. But you know how like you're not supposed to feed the Ewoks after midnight, but then if it's 6 a.m.,
that's a gremlin, not an Ewok.
Oh.
Yeah. You stepped on your own reference joke.
Well, I thought
it's funny because then you came back and looked like an idiot on that one.
He's got you there.
Wow, that really stung. Let's edit that out, huh? Wait, I thought, damn it. I thought they were Miwoks and then they became gremlins. Were they always gremlins? What were the bad ones
called? I'm pretty sure Miwoks are Indians. Now you've gone from Ewoks, which are in Star Wars, to Miwoks, which are Indians. And what you're really going for is gremlins.
Wasn't there a different name between the nice gremlin and the one that got fed after midnight?
There is.
It's like a Moglin.
I like this. He's all technical.
A Mogwai.
Ha! Ha! Give me back my da-da-da-da. I want a redeemed soundtrack. Thank you.
So you've got some Indians, and you can't feed them after dark.
My point that I think I was trying to make 10 minutes ago before I thoroughly embarrassed myself is that she told me, sunlight helps, but not too much sunlight because that'll make it way worse. So now I'm in that uncertain period where I'm not sure if it's going to come back with a vengeance in the next couple days. I suspect probably it will.
Well, this has been fun. I do look forward.
Fun for you.
I do look forward to the medical updates.
It's not.
What
fun.
About salt water in the ocean? Is that supposed to be?
I tried that. It eased the burn a little bit.
Mm. Did you ask any heavyset nude gentlemen to slather you in sunblock? And did they say you're gross because you have body scabies?
No, they accepted.
Are you like the guy from The Night of, the lawyer who has to scratch his feet with pencils?
No. Oh, John Turturro.
Yeah.
That was a good show. Are they going to do, famous TV exec guy, are they going to do another season?
I don't know. Do you have Tevas? Because I think that's got to be the way, your next move.
So speaking of hefty nude men, or should I just say nude men, we ordered something last episode. Go on. We ordered something last episode, and it has arrived. Connor, it is Images You Should Not Masturbate To, one of Amazon's finest books. Dom, I'll hold this up for you.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
So we talked about this last episode.
The back cover is just a horse snout.
The back cover is a horse snout.
I don't know about that one, actually. The horse snout is kind of intriguing.
Well, you know, when we talked about it last time, I don't think I appreciated that the title... oh, my God.
There's a tree. Dom, there's a tree.
Oh, vaginal trees?
Yeah, it's a vaginal tree with various trees. Knots.
There's a whole subreddit dedicated to that.
This, Connor, does this look familiar, like the beach? That's a look.
Oh, wow. That looks like you in a Speedo.
So we'll take some photos. We'll put this on our site. There are many things. Here is what looks like a small child's troll doll.
That is an anatomically correct troll doll.
That is an anatomically correct troll doll. Anyway, like I said, there are some that are odd, so I could not romance myself to an Albanian ashtray. That does not do it for me.
That's pretty nasty.
You know what I really appreciate about this book is that it's not images you cannot masturbate to, it's just should not.
I think it's just that the normal shame one feels after self-gratification is just amplified when one does it to an Albanian ashtray.
Post-release shame, there's a term for that.
Nut remorse.
Yes, thank you.
It is the only time, after a man finishes, that five-minute window before he's ready to go again is the only time that we think clearly. Because it is the only time, as men, that the wanton desire for sex is removed from our consciousness. And we see the world as a woman does, with emotion, feeling, etc. And it's an interesting take. I don't like it.
Is that why I'm always crying afterwards?
Yes. So one of the things, when I ordered this book on Amazon, Amazon suggested used copies for $2 less. I went ahead and sprang for the brand new copy.
I think I'll pitch in the $5.99 for that one.
Yeah, there are many things that I will buy used, books that you can attempt to self-gratify to, I'm going to go ahead and spring for the new
books,
copy.
Books with the word masturbate in their title should not be sold to you. That should just be an Amazon rule.
John, that period of time is called the refractory period.
Ah.
And so it's like a medical term, but you just got me thinking on like a cool new TV show or movie idea. It's like a war room of problem solvers, but I think the average refractory time is like 18 minutes, something like that. You know, it's like a political thriller where like nukes are about to launch. Everyone has to jerk it, and then they have 18 minutes to solve the biggest problems in the world, and the time is ticking. It's like a 24 scenario.
I like this. I could see this on maybe ABC Family, Disney Channel.
the old man making the worst sandcastle I've ever seen.
Connor's now looking back at, he's now perusing images you should not finish.
I am going to prove this title wrong.
I believe you should bring that home. And you and your friend should have a contest and see how many of these pages you can actually complete.
This is a woman wearing a garbage bag poncho pulling a dead horse out of a washing machine. Oh my God, I'm sorry, that's a man. This is my new favorite book.
Dominic, I'm sorry to subject you to the first half of this episode.
I mean, wasting time chit-chatting about stupid stuff is my favorite thing to do.
Do I need to take the book of things you should not self-gratify to away from you?
I think this has become my book of things that I will self-gratify to.
How much longer would you like to peruse the pages of your masturbatory cookbook?
So much. Oh my God, the tree page.
Before we can move on.
Okay, go ahead.
You do realize that you reading a book does not make interesting radio.
But I'm describing the pages. Like, here is an apple that looks distinctively like a butt. That's a butt apple.
There's a subreddit called Mild Vaginas. Sorry, it's called Mildly Vaginas, which makes it actually funnier. And it's just pictures of things that sort of look like vaginas. It's pretty self-explanatory, but okay. Just to let you know, everything's
we're going to have to talk more about that. Okay, Connor, do I need to get a time limit on how much more time you have with nude Putin with an axe?
I just want to point out one more. The right side of the fold is a table saw that looks like it's from 1890. Like, it's connected to a water wheel outside that spins the blade. And then the left side of the page is a succession of what looks like somebody gave Ted Kaczynski a makeover after they pulled him out of the shack in Montana.
Let me take a gander.
So the top left is like crazy Ted Kaczynski, and the bottom right is like, I'd invite that guy to dinner.
So what, in your mind, what is hotter? Oh, yes. What is hotter, serial killer Ted Kaczynski and table saw, or nude Putin chopping ice?
I mean, there's a reason they put nude Putin on the cover. That is amazing.
Yeah, he's fit for a 90-year-old man, maybe because he stands in ice water and chops things.
Chops things.
That guy's been using CRISPR for like 30 years.
That's another tech reference. Okay, now that Connor has had ample time with things you should not masturbate to, I want to talk slightly more seriously about last episode. We had a decorated war hero on, multiple tours in Iraq. I've gotten that right without stumbling this time.
Yeah.
We got a lot of really, really fantastic feedback on that. I want to thank Phil Downs, Captain Phil Downs, again. The honesty was... Actually, I don't know if I could have been so honest given the circumstances, and I think that it's going to help a lot of people. It's already become by far our most downloaded episode, and I hope that some veterans hear that and are able to kind of cope, take away some of the taboo.
Phil's awesome, obviously, and just hearing his voice makes me kind of sound like maybe I'll pick up some of his manliness just as a contagion. It's yet to work, but it was great having him in. I'm glad people have enjoyed the episode. I definitely want to have him back and hear some of the funnier stuff, I guess, if you can say that about being in a war. But, I mean, he had some really powerful, amazing stories, and you know, it's Phil. It was great.
Well, that brings up a good point, which is, if people want to email in, we've gotten a few questions from viewers so far, or listeners. If people want to email in questions for any of our guests or follow-up info or figuring out what is the best way to find links to these types of books on Amazon, you can just go to wildcardshow.com. That's our website. We've got Contact Us page as well as episode blogs where each one of our episodes has pictures and links and all that jazz at wildcardshow.com.
And if anybody wants to pitch a TV show or screenplay to Dominic, our guest today...
I'm all out of ideas, so like, bring them on. Yeah, I'm right
from
there.
Random strangers?
I beg to differ. I think Refractory Period, if not a metal band, definitely needs to be...
You know, a woman's menstrual cycle into that show, too. I don't know how to do it yet, but you could.
if you wanted to extend the amount of time it took them to finish, you could just have people, remember free bleeding? You know what free bleeding is? That's where the woke women do activities in undergarments with no tampons and no underwear.
And they're like, this is just how God made me. It's just deal with it.
Why does everything get a term? This is the problem with the internet. Everything gets a name. It's like the Boston Steamer and the Cleveland Hand Whammy. And like, I don't even think anybody actually does these things.
Well, you can't hashtag I am a woke chick who didn't get my job at HuffPo and I am completely out of ideas but an attention-seeking millennial and I need for people to understand my victimhood. That just doesn't really work as a hashtag.
I started free sneezing on buses just to promote flu shot awareness month, which
again I go back to, there are things that just because they are natural and they are gross does not mean that you need to feel shame about them, but it also doesn't mean you need to take them public. I feel this also happens in the bathrooms at gyms where you can be naked and men can be naked, and that's great and that's fine, but there's also something called hygiene. For example, when I am in a gym, when I'm in the bathroom after I go to the gym, I shower. And yes, I'll be naked for my shower. And then I will dry off. And then because I'm a human being, I put clothes on before I sit on the couch and watch a football game because I don't want to sit on a couch that your bare ass has been on. And then there's the guy who decides to shave naked.
Wait. Your gym bathroom has a couch and a TV?
Yeah. No, it's like they have like a whole men's
Congress?
It's a men's club.
Exactly. A men's club.
Oh, fancy.
I know. You probably don't ever see outside the sauna.
I go to a poor man's gym, apparently.
Again, I come back to, if I'm sitting on a bench and I have a lower locker and I'm trying to put on my shoes and you come over and you have the upper locker, don't take your towel off to prove to me how self-assured you are and then awkwardly lean over me with your towel in your hand and attempt to get into your locker while you talk to me awkwardly when my head is at genital height. And then there's the guy who does the shaving. I actually witnessed this. He goes up to like the area where you got the sinks and everything, and he starts shaving. And he's leaning over. You know how you kind of lean over the basin to get close to the mirror while you're shaving?
You got to put your testicles in the sink to keep them safe.
And his whatnot is literally smearing the leftover water around the basin like some sort of Rorschach test. And I'm just, my mind is blowing. I'm like, people have to go and wash their hands there. Can you have a little decency and just put a towel on?
I would be worried that my schmeckle would get something from people's dirty hands.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. That sounds worse for him than for anybody else.
No, it's bad for me. I really don't care if his schmeckle gets hand psoriasis. I just don't want his schmeckle bits on my hands.
Don't wish schmeckle psoriasis on anybody. I tell you from experience, it's not a nice thing.
But why? Anyway, I don't know why I get so fired up about this. I don't care about nudity. I care about hygiene.
Because you're easily excitable. That's why you get fired up. I think my favorite gym locker room move was the time I walked in. It was a 24-hour, and you know, 24 hours lowbrow. It's not like your fancy couch having gym.
What's the best hour of the 24?
You know, I'm glad you bring that up because the 24-hour that I go to closes at 10 p.m. on the weekends. Change your goddamn name to 18-hour, you dicks.
Yeah,
are they allowed to keep their charter and do that?
Apparently that's allowed. No, so I go to the 24-hour, and they've got, like, the bus stop bench, you know, in the locker room where it's just an elevated piece of wood that has seen many a bare butt. And I walk in there one time, and there was this man roughly the age of, I want to say, 70 million, who was standing not on the ground, but on the bench facing the door to the locker room. And he must have showered in the sink or the shower. I'm not sure. I wasn't there. But he was standing on the bench with a paper towel from the paper towel dispenser, drying himself, just facing the rest of the room with his paper towel standing on the bench, butt-ass naked.
Standing on the bench.
On the bench.
Like he was Rocky and he had gotten to the top of the stairs.
So he's elevated himself such that the old man kibbles and bits are right at eye level, which was great. Of course, I seated myself in a position for excellent viewing and then pretended like I couldn't remember the code to my padlock.
And that's when it got awkward.
I think this is the first time I've heard a good usage of a selfie, because I've never selfied in my whole life. But I think in those scenarios, you do it just to just to sort of shame other people out of their behavior.
I totally agree. And you don't want to make it one of those, you know how sometimes you'll be in a restaurant and you want to snap something kind of on the sly?
Oh, no, it's obvious.
Yeah, no, you got to like smile and get into it like you're taking, like you're 12 years old and you're taking a picture with Mickey at Disneyland.
Yeah, you got to get right in there. Just crushed my workout on a Friday night at 11 p.m. while you guys are out drinking.
The thing is,
hashtag workout, hashtag fit life, hashtag clean living.
24 hour. It's kind of like those the playgrounds in the city where they have signs that say you can't go in this playground if you're not accompanied by a child.
Yes,
it's like 24 hour has the signs that say seriously don't take pictures in the locker room. Which in both cases, it's like if the person is gonna creep onto a playground to lurk at little kids. Or lurk at other people in the bathroom, they're probably not going to listen to your sign.
Yes,
like if you're a pederast or a gym
like
selfie.
Stop human trafficking signs. You're like, I'm either doing this professionally.
You know,
I don't think the sign's going to stop
I was going to.
Or beating elderly people. Yeah. That's my thing.
I was going to smuggle some underage children in my carry-on bag, but then I saw that sign and, you know, I really thought better of it.
I don't even know why I write out a show rundown for this, because I have all these topics I want to cover, and then we get 5 minutes in and we've talked about free bleeding, old man nakedness at the gym, and unfortunately for Dominic, he has been forced to cancel many of his power lunches, his celebrity Hollywood power lunches, and sit with us. So I'd like to move on to Dominic now.
Let's do that.
Dom, explain to me what the luxurious, exciting life of a Hollywood show creator is like, and what specifically you do.
So I develop television shows and I pitch them and sell them to networks and studios, which we call buyers. So that's the generic broad strokes kind of what I do.
How does one get into this? Because I would feel terribly insecure trying to write and pitch things. Do you just sit down and you're like, I have a great idea for a show? I'm going to write this down. You got these guys. You got a refractory period. I've got 18 minutes. This is gold.
Yeah. I mean, my first piece of advice is don't get into this business. It's the worst. Stay away. Stay far, far away. The other thing is there's no barriers to entry really other than kind of who you know and how you can finagle. So then that sort of invites a ton of yahoos to just come from everywhere and start schlepping projects. So it sort of invites like ultimate car salesman types of people mixed with, you know, people that have dreams. And so anybody, you don't need a degree, you don't need anything. So anybody can sort of walk into LA and just try to start selling TV.
What is the worst idea that someone has pitched you and was ready to sell their house and put all their money behind making this?
Frank Stallone pitched Pie Face. Frank Stallone's Sly's brother, who's the, I don't know if you follow him on Instagram, but I would.
Does he free bleed?
he free bleeds all day. You can, there's a guy version of free bleeding.
I'm sure.
So it was called Pie Face, I think. And it was just some kind of a game show where people got pies in the face. And it was kind of that. It was like a one pager, as we call it, which means there's not a lot of detail. And it's not that thought out or developed. It's Pie Face. And you know, he's hoping to just, someone goes, I like it. What ended up happening was there was a game show or a board game that, I think you guys played that Pie Face board game. We put your face in this little hole and then this hand comes up and slaps you in the face with whipped cream. Got popular last Christmas. I think he's laughing at us now. Dude's killing.
Wow. Frank Stallone making millions.
The biggest thing is it's never that the idea is terrible. It's usually that most people just don't have the follow through to see a project through. I mean, if you just sort of examine most television shows, like a lot of them aren't that complicated, especially comedies. Like the premises are sort of broad, which means it's not the premise that sells the show. Typically, it's kind of how you sell it and how you get it sold, which is like sort of the other side of TV, which is why, you know, you got to be in LA, you got to go to the casting couch, you got to, you know, take your clothes off, you got to do a lot of Weinsteining, as we call it.
I like you've made that a verb. So you moved down to LA. I want to say you were what, a young puckish, what, 23 or 24? You moved onto a boat with some big ideas and a waitering job.
I ended up getting a job working for Barbara Streisand as a roadie. That's why I left the greatest job ever, working behind a bar. And
well, she's a comedy heavyweight, so that opens a lot of doors for you.
Yep. She, oh man, what a riot she was.
Really? Barbara Streisand, not super down to earth and fun.
You know, it was, she's one of those people that you weren't allowed to look at. You had to keep your distance. It was
okay.
Like,
hold on. Are you being serious? Cause I hear this, but I don't actually believe this.
She's the general and you're just a peon in the army. And so my, you know, relationship with her is almost nothing. There is nothing. It's just, I work in that circus.
Did someone actually come to you and say, don't look her in the eyes? And if you ask her a question, do you have to look down when you bring her the coffee?
There was never a chance where somebody like me was going to interact with her. I mean, honestly, because of my peon status. But that was my roadie life, which brought me to Los Angeles, which is kind of how I ended up moving here. And then I started making comedy content with a friend of mine, and we put it up on a website, which we called fifthyear.com, which was the coolest. We started filming different ways to get drunk for college kids. Like, that was our whole premise, was we're going to provide kids with different ways to get wasted and blacked out. In a creative way.
That is the gating item for college kids getting drunk, is they can't think of any ways to do it.
Yeah.
Right. When we thought we were the best, you know, we were like, we're a crack team. We got this idea.
You buy a funnel from Home Depot, attach it to a tube, and then you pour multiple beers in it at once.
We would have scoffed at that, John. That's just...
That's juvenile. That's
so JV.
That's rookie. JV.
That's so rook.
I mean, I remember one
of your... butt chugging?
We're going to go down that road?
That's rook too. I mean, those are all one.
Butt chugging is rook. Putting anything in my anus, including Royal Gate vodka, to me is not rookie. That's a great Saturday.
Tampon vodka, is that one? That's another one too.
That was big in like 2009.
That was after us.
Can we explain at least what this is to the sophisticated members of our audience that may not have butt chugged?
I don't think we have any of those.
So we've covered free bleeding and old man balls. So let's move on to butt chugging.
Sure.
Well, Connor, you seem to know about its history.
No, go ahead, John. You're chomping at the bit here.
My understanding of butt chugging is that anything that can be ingested in the mouth can also be ingested by the anus.
Minus the liver.
Minus the liver. That's a good point. The stomach is what's called, it has a first pass. And when it comes to drugs and chemicals, typically they estimate that about 50% of what is consumed is cut out by the stomach. Basically, if you ingest, say, 1,000 milligrams of, I don't know what the kids are doing these days, Molly
ketamine,
or something.
It's
ketamine.
All Molly these days. It's all ball bearings.
Half of that goes poof. So you wasted your money. But thankfully, God has provided us with an anus that is so multifunctional that if you were to take that Molly and ram it up the backside.
Wolf of Wall Street, remember?
Yes.
Yeah, that's right.
Yes. If you were to take pretty much any drug and stick it up the bottom end as opposed to in the top end, you're doubling your potency. So that's twice as many Molly trips.
Just for the sake of us not getting sued and ruining our budget of $0.
This is not medical advice.
Yeah, let's make very clear here. We're discussing something that kids have made the poor decision of doing. It's actually super dangerous because your liver's not involved. You can get hammered on like one tampon of booze.
Which is why I only drink espresso.
Which
is a pretty shitty joke.
That's why he's a professional, ladies and gentlemen. Wait a minute. This made me think of something else I wanted to talk about. Dominic, I remember one of your videos around this time. Speaking of creative ways to get drunk, this was one of those like murder mystery parties at the mansion, except it wasn't at a mansion and there weren't other suspects. It was clearly you killing yourself. You appeared to still be drunk from the night before. And you administered yourself an IV that I think was full of booze, or maybe it just wasn't, and you missed the vein and hit an artery, and it looked like... It's on video, and it's at least 13% of what I just said is accurate. I remember the last line of the video.
We used to do IVs that we would rip off from various fire departments in town. And it was, well, just like we were saying, I mean, with the tampon vodka ass, it's the same philosophy. It's like if you're hungover and you're trying to rehydrate and you chug 4 Gatorades, you're going to piss 80% of that water out and not absorb the water. So it's the same thing with an IV, right? It's like if you just go straight in the vein, you're going to actually keep those fluids. So you rehabilitate quicker. That's the thing. So yeah, I would be in San Francisco and we would be driving back to LA. And so we would do these IVs before the 6-hour drive down the 5, which is horrible. One time, my IV was, we would use a coat hanger to hang it like on a door jam, mm-hmm. kind of the way it worked. And so you'd sit there against the wall and you'd be taking your IV bag. But I mean, the real pro move, I had a friend in the Navy who would say, this is how we used to do it. And they would microwave the bags first, so they get them all warm. And it's kind of like getting in a hot tub where, you know, you get in a hot tub, your skin and everything gets warm. But if you inject warm water in your body, your whole body then heats up to that temperature, which is kind of a fun thing to do.
Not dangerous at all. You know, I'm just sitting here with a guy who learned in the Navy to microwave IVs, hang them from coat hangers in a car while you drive down the 5. Sounds like a standard medical procedure.
I'm just impressed, Dominic, that with the benefit of 12 years of maturity, you are telling this story with zero regret.
I think it was scientifically...
no, there was no science.
Logical. It made sense. But then, of course, like at one point, the IV line, my friend was stepping over me and his foot kicked it out of my arm. The tube came out, so it left the stent exposed and then just started misting blood. It's not a squirt. It's like a mist, right? And it's like a fine... And it starts misting. And of course, it mists at the rate of your heartbeat, which is...
That's a look.
Kind of rhythmic.
And so kind of missed at his wall. bad about. And then, you know, of course, we just started laughing because it was funny.
He was free bleeding.
He was free bleeding.
We're bringing it back.
I just remember the last line of the video was Dominic lying on the floor, clearly still drunk from the day before or that morning, just in a pool of his own blood. And he goes, I feel like I got murdered. And then it fades to black.
We actually took all of these concepts and stuff and we pitched them as a book, which we sold. So I don't know if you didn't mention this in my bio, but I'm a published author also, guys.
I'm sorry.
The Party Bible, The Good Book for Great Times, which you could buy on Amazon for, I think, like $1.99 right now. It's a steal, which I think I'll get like 11 cents of that. So
should one masturbate to your book?
How many of the pages in your book can one masturbate successfully to?
I think, Connor, you might be in the book, actually.
Oh, so then definitely, yes, you should masturbate.
So there goes one page.
That's a yes.
We took pictures of all of our friends during those years and just put them in the book. We didn't ask anybody if it was okay.
No rights signed.
Nothing. And we just said, oh, we know these people. They won't care. And, you know, people have turned out to be attorneys and
podcast hosts.
I think on our side, we didn't... You know, it never got.
So before we move on to how your career really started to take off, I wanted to talk more about one of the things that made you such an interesting guest. And I thought you would be a great person to have on in addition to the Hollywood stuff is kind of your involvement with Reddit. And you've got a podcast called Did You Reddit?
We're the number one Reddit based podcast.
Yeah. So tell me more about Reddit, because I know kind of on the surface what Reddit is, but I certainly have not gone down into the deeper layers like you all have.
Well, our podcast is, you know, our sort of catchphrase is we do a podcast about the internet by way of Reddit, the front page of the internet. So Reddit is, you know, they call themselves the front page of the internet. And it's kind of this conglomerate of everything that happens on the internet on a daily basis comes through this Reddit, I don't know, filter really. And so it's a great way to just get a daily snapshot of what's going on out there in the world, but also specifically like weird niche stuff on the internet. And so Reddit has a thing called subcategories. Those subs are user generated and so that means anybody can start any sub based on any topic they want. So because of that, it's the subs are literally endless, right? Like anything that you're into, like ass bleeding, can become a sub. And you just start it, you become a moderator, and then people start to use it and comment, and you can build a community that way. And so there's obviously more popular subs and less popular subs. And so what we do on the podcast is we pick a sub of the week and we talk about that sub as it pertains to what's going on in culture today. That's kind of the structure of our show. And so like last week we did one on the Golden State Killer because that's been news. And so there's a huge community of Redditors that are sort of made themselves investigators. And so they're trying to figure out. And so it's obviously like a hot topic on Reddit right now. And so that's kind of the crux of the show.
So I was really excited to have Dominic on because it's like the Jetsons meet the Flintstones. Do you remember those? Having another famous podcast host on our podcast is like, it's like this beautiful meeting of the minds. Reddit to me is confusing and scary, as most things are. And I feel like it's going to be very similar to, I go on a lot of the forums, you know, the 4i with, I got the car questions and stuff, because I have like seven cars that are all worth $100.
How come nobody ever answers the question on the forum? Someone asks a question and then it just goes off.
I'm sorry, I have to interject here for a second, because this bothers the shit out of me. Yahoo Answers might be the biggest waste of time ever, because you're like, am I the only one sitting around who thinks they have leprosy because their body is covered in red rashy bumps? I know what I'll do. I'll search the old interwebs and find out if anyone else has leprosy. So you go on there and your exact question pops up. You're like, yes, there's two answers. I am not the only person with leprosy. And then you read the first answer and it's like, that's a great question. I have these bumps too. And then the next person is like, I too would like to know if I am a leper. And then no one gets an answer to anything. And you've wasted all this time and gotten no useful information whatsoever. Don't post, asshole. I don't want to come here with two questions and two comments.
Like, sorry to hear. Yeah. That must itch.
My favorite thing is it'll be like, August 2012. I have these red bumps. Does anybody know what's going on with that? August 13th, 2012. Yeah, I have that too. And then it's like, April 2017. Did anyone ever get an answer to this? Like, that is Yahoo Answers.
Did the first two answer people die?
I hope it wasn't deadly, whatever those bumps were. But I go on the 4i for the car stuff to try to keep all of my crappy-ass cars running, and it's always the exact same exchange. How do you replace a windshield in a 72 Buick? And then 13 people will respond with like, there's already a sub on that dick face. Get off the internet. You're an idiot. Use the search function. Why can't you figure this out yourself? And you just, it's like trying to make friends in high school. You're like, why am I even bothering? I'm just going to go home and get homeschooled. Anyway, I bring this up because I'm curious. Is Reddit like that, or can I find nice people there?
No, you're going to get trolled big time. I mean, that's kind of the deal.
There's no safe space on the internet.
There's a set of rules for Reddit that there's like 65 of them. There might actually be 69 just because it's the internet. But it breaks down like what will happen on the internet. And like, they're really funny. I mean, it's like if somebody claims to be a 14-year-old girl, he's definitely a 46-year-old man. Like, there are all these great internet rules and you're definitely going to get trolled. There's a good subreddit called Ken M. Just Ken and the letter M. And this guy's like the famous internet troll. And he lures people into these arguments, like through places like Yahoo questions and stuff. And they're, I mean, what Reddit's great for is if you like to read sort of the culture of the internet and like see people get trolled and like, you know, verbally ripped apart, it's good for those kinds of things. But it's also good for information. I mean, I use it as a daily news site. The subreddit, just World News, is great for just like a snapshot of what's happening today. And I can talk to you about some of like the big generic ones if you get like for.
Yeah,
for
I mean, you really piqued my interest because one of the critiques of our show is that we go off on tangents because I don't know, maybe we're just a little bit too ADD. But
that totally reminded me something. Do you remember Punky Brewster?
Oh, for fuck's sake.
Hey, you remember the 90s? Crazy time.
Right? God, that was the best decade.
As I said, one of the things that we get critiqued on is going off on tangents, but there are some absolutely fascinating things on your show that I was really, really interested in. You talked about the Golden State Killer or the East Area Rapist or whatever the names are. I didn't even understand this until I kind of got filled in on it. What an interesting story this is. Because this is not just someone who got caught from police DNA, but it's a whole deeper kind of story than that.
The information's a little cloudy. I'm kind of trying to figure it out, but it sounds like his daughter got arrested for dealing drugs. Her DNA was banked through the arrest system. I don't really know how that works. And then through that, it matched up with a DNA hit from all of these connected rapes and murders who they didn't know who it was, right? They just had, they knew whoever was doing this was the same person, but they didn't know the person's identity. And then when it matched up with his daughter's DNA, they said, oh my God, whoever's father this is or mother is our person, right? So I don't think a mom was raping all these people, but so that's kind of how it trickled down. And I think more information is going to come out because this only happened last week.
Yeah, my understanding of it, and one of the reasons I found it so fascinating is we hear about all these websites now, the 23andMe and the various DNA sites. And one of the techniques that police and maybe even folks on Reddit use now is kind of this familial DNA, this relative DNA. So what happens is you've got someone committing murders in, I'm not sure when he was operating, the 70s or something like that. Pre-DNA, I think fingerprinting and blood analysis were very much in their infancy. And so they've got DNA.
Fingerprinting's been around for like 100 years.
Okay. So
remember
that I'm wrong on that.
Remember that time I said Miwok and I meant the gremlins?
You just get me back.
Joke's on you, jerk.
So many, many forms of police investigation,
yes!
shall we say, were in their infancy. And they had DNA from this serial rapist, serial killer, but they didn't have any crimes or he wasn't in the crime database. And to your point, like a daughter was arrested and I had heard, and again, I think more will come out on this, that there may have been some other relatives in one of these websites. I don't think it was 23andMe. It may have been, but let's just Ancestry.com or one of those. And what would happen is you share, so he has daughters and they don't have exact DNA, but they share a certain percentage. And what they were able to do is say, oh, this serial killer shares DNA with these 20 people on Ancestry.com. And let's look at all the people that are related to these people, who was alive, who was in kind of the Sacramento or East area at this time. And they narrowed it down to this this guy that was arrested.
Yeah, they can narrow the search, exactly.
And once they got a name, they followed him around and then surreptitiously got DNA from him, whether it's a coffee cup, a Starbucks cup, or whatever.
And we don't know how, right? I don't think that information's out.
They haven't disclosed that. I would assume it was out of garbage because they
something
can do
like that.
They can do that, I think, without a search warrant. No, I mean, Dominic, if you guys, and by you guys, I mean Hollywood, don't make a movie out of this investigative process starring Jake Gyllenhaal, I will personally consider you a failure because this is one of the most amazing stories, just the investigative process that played out over a quarter century.
Are you referencing Zodiac and Mark Ruffalo? Good, really good movie.
Thank you.
I love Zodiac.
He gets my references. I kind of want to do a podcast with Dominic instead of John because he gets my references.
It's a good point you bring up. I mean, you can pretty much assume this is already in the works, guaranteed, right? Because it's so big. But if any story, so Hollywood kind of works on this concept of IP. People say IP, intellectual property, right? And so when a studio or a network is, you know, hypothetically going to sink, would you say $100 million might be the cost that it takes to make the first season of a TV series. You know, if they're going to invest that much money, they want to sort of hedge their bet, right? And it's sort of their philosophy. So they want to base it on something that has intellectual property or at least like a built-in audience that will come with their bet. So when people are about to invest in a show and buy a show, if you have an IP backing it up, you have a little bit more of an opportunity or chance to sell your project. So this obviously, you know, the country is obsessed with this. The world's obsessed with this. Of course, this is going to make money on the back end. So people are chomping at the bit to invest in this. They want this. And because it's public domain, you might actually see a few different versions of it come out over time. Like you probably just won't see one. But any article in the New Yorker, in the New York Times, in the Washington Post that was big, you can almost bet some producer out there has reached out to the author and we call it optioning the rights. So they essentially legally stake a claim to the rights to that story for some period of time. And then in that time, let's just say, for example, for 12 months, John, you write a story about how you used to be called DBDB and you were a fat douchebag and you used to do this thing at night where, give me a thing you used to do at night. What'd you used to eat?
I would eat baguettes with just mayonnaise, no fillings on the sandwich. I would just slather it with some Best Foods, and I would wash it down with possibly some apple juice and any sort of other cracker I could find.
Your dad told me that you guys used to go to Carl's Jr. and you would get the 40-ounce soda, you know, just like diabetes in a can. And your dad said, yeah, and then by the time we pulled out of the Arby's, I could hear from the back seat, like it was already empty.
So hypothetically, this story is something people got into and wanted to read. So some producer, you know, would have reached out and optioned the rights from whoever wrote the story.
And how much is my shame as it can be, a baloney-titted 12-year-old worth?
It's relevant to how popular the story is, right? So the Golden State story obviously is massive, but there's also a lot of stories about it. So.
And who would you even pay in a situation like the Golden State Killer? Who would you option the story from? I mean, not the Golden State Killer.
I think if somebody like the New Yorker did, or like Rolling Stones did a comprehensive 15-page story and they really broke it down in a way that, or even better yet, you know, Patton Oswalt's wife wrote a book about this right before she passed away. She published it. Did you know that?
No.
So Patton Oswalt's a comedian and his wife wrote this book all about this. She's been like obsessed
about the Golden State Killer.
She's been obsessed with it for like her whole life.
And she passed away?
She just passed away. Like,
what a rat year, fuck. Right before.
Ago. Yeah. Like kind of out of the blue cancer thing. So books, another thing, another way to option, right? So someone's probably already optioned that, right? And whoever owns her estate, which is probably him, will be the one getting paid. So they negotiate a term sheet like for 12 months or 18 months. I have the right to go sell this for, it's usually not that much money. I mean, it's, it kind of depends on the gravity of the story. Like maybe it's 10 to 50 grand. I don't know. I mean, this story is huge, so it's probably a lot.
DB would be closer to the 50K number, I'm guessing.
For sure.
DB, yours might be like $1,000 for 24 months. And you're essentially just right. You're buying the right.
Fat kid with a heart of gold.
So, and so Connor being the producer would, now he just optioned those rights from you. And so now Connor's job is to go sell it. And so what he needs next is, because he's not a writer, he needs to go attach a writer to the project, which is kind of where I come into the thing. So Connor, producer, would approach me and say, I have this story about a guy that used to eat baguette mayonnaise sandwiches. I think you're the perfect writer for this because you've done a couple of TV shows like this. And let's form a team and then we'll go out and we'll pitch it and sell it. And so that's one way you sell and create television shows. And so
you get paid by, you would get paid by someone that options it, or do you also create ideas on your own? And then
I typically wouldn't get paid in that scenario. It's more of just a, it's, you're sort of gambling together, right? You're going,
investing your own time. Yeah,
exactly. So that's one way I will join on to a project is somebody else's idea, not my own. But I'm interested in that because if it does have some amount of popularity already, it's hedging the bet that we're going to sell it too. So it's a good thing. The other way to do it is to come up with your own idea from scratch that has zero IP or, you know, nobody's ever heard of it. And it's maybe a little more risky or rare to do that. It's not impossible. I mean, it happens all the time. But that's kind of the other way to do it, is just a fresh idea that has zero IP behind it. So
hence refractory period.
Can we trademark that before this episode goes to air? I just want to make sure none of our listeners steal that.
See you in court, sucko. Yeah.
Refractory, starring Dominic Russo. So I have actually two questions I want to ask you. I know you're not on the movie side, but I'm sure this happens on the TV side as well, which is, why is it that it seems like every year or so, something just all of a sudden becomes the thing that we're going to make movies about? Like in 1996, it was, dadgabbit, we need a movie about an asteroid destroying the Earth. And mm-hmm. I'm going to make Armageddon, where Ben Affleck saves us. And over
Deep
here,
Impact.
We're going to make Deep Impact, where Steve Buscemi and Bruce Willis save us?
No, it was Morgan Freeman was a black president. Remember?
But Steve Buscemi was up on the rock.
No, that was Armageddon.
Oh. Well, you see my point.
My money's on Steve Buscemi.
Yeah.
You know, remember they land on the thing and he's like, we can't drill in. It's too far. How do you know, Steve Buscemi? And he looks back and they cut to him and he goes, because I'm a genius. And they're like, oh, okay.
That's strong. How do you rate that?
That's good writing right there.
He's a ragtag genius.
Yeah. He plays by his own rules.
Mm-hmm.
He's like a grown-up Will Hunting.
It's actually kind of a similar philosophy as IP. Backing a project with IP. I mean, if another major studio is going to sink, like that movie probably costs $150 million. Like if some other movie studio thinks there's enough interest to bet $150 million on the end of the world via asteroid, other studios will probably say, all right, they did it, we'll do it too. I mean, it's essentially like...
Hollywood are very sheepish. I've noticed that. They don't like to stick their neck out. Maybe it's because stuff is so expensive.
I don't know. You know, it's also one of those industries where, you know, the turnover with executives at these companies is you get 1 to 2 years to sort of make a good movie. And then if you can't, you'll get fired and moved along to another company. So I think executives don't want to bet on the wrong thing, right? I mean, it's a shitload of money. And so they're saying if John did it and it and it worked out, like, we're going to do it too. And it's sort of an excuse to not be fired, I guess. And I mean, I don't know. Were there multiple Twister type movies? Probably, right?
Well, they made like four of them, didn't they? I don't know why those people couldn't just like move out of the Midwest.
Why couldn't Liam Neeson's daughter stay the fuck home? I mean, it's like nine takes.
Stop going to Europe.
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, why wouldn't you? So if you're a studio and you have an audience that you've already developed, a Fast and Furious is a good example. Like, I don't know how much money they've made total over billions, the course of that franchise. Yeah. It's in the high billions. I mean, it's not like a couple.
Crushing
insane
it.
Amount. Yeah, once you already sort of build this humongous audience, they want to keep milking that teat, right, until it's just totally dead. And that's the business side of it.
One of the movies that I thought was really interesting just in the way that it played out on the market was Passion of the Christ, because it wasn't, you know, I don't think they did that much broad promotion in the way that a typical blockbuster does, but it came in with such an established and enthusiastic demographic.
You could say it's the original IP.
It is.
Yeah.
I mean, best-selling book. You're pandering to an audience that is, for lack of a better term, religious about your topic.
It's the same philosophy as getting the IP for DBDB. It's the exact same idea on just a bigger scale. Right?
I like that a movie about Christ and my autobiography, DBDB, are in the same. Those are competitive, like Deep Impact and Armageddon, right?
John as a fat kid versus our Lord and Savior gets crucified. But no, I was going somewhere with this, which is that it seems
Clarissa
like some
explains it all, or yes, the 90s.
Do you remember when her friend, you remember her friend used to climb in through the window?
And, no, let's not go down this tangent.
Oh no, we're going to go down this tangent. So you remember Clarissa Explains It All, right? Most of the show took place in her upstairs bedroom, and she had the friend who would creepily climb in through her window via a ladder.
It was like Max or something cool.
Something like that, like Jimmy. And for the first couple seasons, Jimmy would come in and he would like hang out with Clarissa. Sometime around season three or season four, the poor kid who played Jimmy developed just atrocious acne. And I can say this because I have full body acne as we speak. And so they stopped letting him come forward from the window. he would climb up the elevator and he'd have to just stay at the window and Clarissa would talk to him from there. It was so mean.
That's good directing.
Yeah. Do you watch Modern Family and have you seen Manny? Because if you haven't, you need to take a gander at this. So I've talked about him in the past because I feel like in many respects we're soulmates. I firmly believe that Manny, in addition to his love of musicals, also enjoys baguettes with mayo.
And Manny is your spirit animal.
He is my spirit animal. And you look at the first few seasons and he's small and chubby and a great character. And then all of a sudden, someone gave him human growth hormone over the summer. He went from being 4'2" to 6'4". He's the size of an NFL middle linebacker now. He looks nothing like his former self. And it is so awkward because he's supposed to be this tiny little like sympathetic, funny, musical loving kid. And the guy, again, he looks like a middle linebacker for the Packers.
I don't watch
his
show.
His voice dropped.
So
he went from like, I love musicals to I love musicals. And it just doesn't work anymore.
Let's close the loop on Jesus Christ. You're sort of proposing a problem that, you know, a group of writers would have to figure out an answer for, which is essentially what your job is. But Connor, God.
Okay, Jesus Christ,
Passion
of the Christ.
Can you sum up God in 30 seconds?
Or? No, I mean, so the reason I bring up Passion of the Christ is because there are projects that seem like they have a built-in customer base. And that's probably the best example where you almost didn't even have to market it. They basically just sent out an AOL email to all of the Baptist ministers around the country. And it got this massive, just natural network effect and made a ton of money without a lot of traditional promotion.
That one specifically was Mel Gibson just do whatever the fuck he wants. But yeah, I mean, obviously that's a big reason why a project will either get bought or not get bought. I mean, when, you know, you could have a great idea that's super clever and awesome, but if they don't think there's an audience for it, it just won't fly. And a big part of why something gets rejected, you know, there's been this resurgence of Hollywood's very liberal and sort of very anti-religion. There's been this sort of, you know, Kirk Cameron from, I mean, he's sort of been making all these Christian-based films for the last 10, 15 years. He's like super Christian, and they make a shitload of money, and we've never heard of them.
Yeah.
So there's this huge Christian market that's like maybe, you know, your flyover Midwest state group of people that don't really have any content for them. And so if you're a smart investor, I mean, it would be a good place to invest in film.
That's interesting. Put together like a portfolio of religious oriented content.
Yeah,
to invest
yeah. Because the chances that they'll probably they're more set up to succeed than your average Oscar movie. I mean, nobody's really watching a lot of those Oscar nominated movies. They're just not for that many people, right? You know, except for Hollywood people to sort of jerk themselves off and be like, these are beautiful.
Yeah.
But if you're going for the bucks, yeah, religion's a great way to go.
So
there's an industry for it, and you kind of got to just look for it.
So what kind of stuff have you been successful with? You know, we've talked about being a writer and a creator, and I know the question people are going to ask is, you know, what have you had a chance to work on or be a part of, et cetera?
Please don't ever ask me the question, what kind of stuff have you been successful with? Because I can't answer that.
So I went to Arizona State, which is a top school, according to Playboy, for parties and good-looking women. That's what it's known for, right? And so I was
talking more about shows and that kind of thing. Women will only make me feel insecure.
I'm just telling once I'm like backing up with my resume. So out of there, you know, most people are just getting sort of your first, you know, out of college crappy sales job, which are miserable. And we decided to make this web series about people in their first shitty out of college sales jobs, because web series were becoming a thing. This was like in 2007. Web series were sort of on the precipice of this new thing. MySpace was out. There was, what else? YouTube started in 2005, I think. So this was 2007. So 2 years after that, we made 5 webisodes, about 5 minutes long each. So it was about 25 minutes worth of content. And then we used that content to pitch the show to different networks. And then Comedy Central gave us money to go make a pilot presentation, which I can describe. But that money, that show turned into Workaholics, which was a show on Comedy Central, which went for 7 years. So that's kind of...
Oh, yeah, no, I absolutely know Workaholics. And, you know, 7 years on a comedy channel, that's an impressive run.
It's nostalgically funny if you were ever in college and sort of a dumb stoner drunk kid.
I would be absolutely terrified if I had done kind of a web series where you're kind of owning the content and you have kind of total creative flexibility, and then a behemoth like Comedy Central is like, yeah, we'll pay for a pilot. Or I mean, I would be terrified at that point.
Yeah, I remember just trying to sort of play it cool and like not be exposed for knowing nothing. Like, oh fuck, they don't know that I don't. You know, it's like, I remember thinking, I don't know how to write scripts at all. Like, either, you know, so the first stage is called this pilot presentation stage, which a lot of these people do. And they essentially give you a chunk of money to go make a fake pilot. Like, what would a pilot look like for the show?
And how much money? How much money do they give you?
They give us $50,000. So that money, we thought was more money than God, right? It was like, we're like, holy shit, we can make a whole season. They're like, calm down, guys. Like, make one episode. Doesn't have to be a full episode. Just make 10 good minutes. And what they're doing is they're using that sale. It's essentially a sales tool for their bosses.
Got it.
You know, the executive that we worked with gave us sort of the green light for that money to then make this thing called the pilot presentation, which then he takes and shows internally, you know, to his bosses. And then he's become the champion of the show. And so he's going like, guys, you should order this show for next year's cycle. Based off of that material we just made. And we went for it and we made a full episode and it turned out really great. And they ordered 10 episodes and it was like, holy shit, they're going along with this thing. Like, in the kind of the back of your mind, you're sort of going like, this will just eventually say no.
Yeah, you have to, because it's such a long shot to be successful in that business.
Yeah, so it's almost better to hedge your emotions in the negative side. I mean, hope for the best, but it's probably not going to work out. And that's kind of the bumper sticker of Hollywood.
You know, what's funny is sometimes, I mean, I've been involved with a lot of product development and candidates and even actually TV shows too. Every so often you'll see something where early on you're like, there's something to this. This might actually work. And I remember watching those webisodes when you guys first put them up online. I was like, this is actually good. Like, normally Dominic's just kind of a drunk who stabs himself in the artery, but this is pretty good. And then you organized a comedy show. This was after you had done the webisodes, but before you were pitching to Comedy Central. And the chubby kid from the show, the one who kind of looks like me, but like he eats too much.
What's Adam Devine, yeah.
Yeah.
That guy's going to love that intro. If he ever wins an Emmy, that's the intro he wants.
Whatever, I don't care.
I look like the guy that has leprosy, except chubbier.
Yeah, I don't care because he kind of big-timed me that night. Dominic introduced me, and I was like, hey, man, how's it going? He just turned and started talking to these girls, and I was like, hey, I'm cool too. But anyway, he went on. He did a set, and he was hysterical. It was just one of those things where, in retrospect, you realize, like, yeah, you know, it kind of makes sense that this one worked.
Do you remember that was the biggest night of your life, I think?
Oh, I'm so glad you brought that up. I am so glad you brought that. I wanted to tell that story, but I felt like if I forced it upon the conversation, it would seem forced. But
it was a pretty amazing thing to put in your personal resume.
So Dominic organizes this comedy show, and he had, you know, there were some good people. They were like comedians who were getting started out, or maybe local performers. And all of a sudden, the stage handler lady comes over, and she's like, pss, 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 pss. Well, it turns out Dave Chappelle just showed up out of nowhere and was like, I feel like going on, and basically bumped everybody else. They're just like, clear the stage. Get out of here, you losers. Dave Chappelle is here. And this was in that period, like right after he got back from Africa, when he left his show and disappeared.
He's very mysterious.
So he was like a mysterious, but he was like Bruce Wayne. He did like 20 minutes of traditional stand-up comedy material, and then it was just Dave Chappelle hanging out, just like taking questions, riffing on stuff. It was basically the best podcast you've ever seen. And since Dominic had organized the thing, we had gotten there early, and so I happened to be sitting right in front, like my feet were on the stage, so I would like help Dave Chappelle light his cigarette. And and so at one point in the conversation, this has got to be like 3 a.m at this point, somebody's like, what about Samuel L. Jackson? And so Dave Chappelle starts riffing on Samuel L. Jackson, and he starts doing Ezekiel 25:17 from Pulp Fiction. And I'm like, oh my God, this is going to be amazing. This just became my new favorite night of my life. And he starts doing it, and he's like, oh yeah, man, the path down the right path. And I'm like, wait a minute, he's kidding, right? Like, hey, everybody knows Ezekiel 25:17. It is beginning. And he's stumbling through it. And finally, I'm just like, I can't let this go on. I have to intervene. I mean, I feel like I've been chosen to be here at this time in this place. The path of the righteous man is beset on all sides by the inequities of the human spirit and the tyranny of evil men. Blessed is he who in the name of charity and goodwill shepherds the weak through the valley of darkness. And at this point, Dave Chappelle takes the mic, puts it right in my face, and he's like, just keep going, man. Just keep going. Blessed is he. And I'm kind of toning it down so I don't hurt our listeners' ears, but I was getting like full red face, like head shaking, you know, the veins are popping out of your neck. For he is truly his brother's keeper and the finder of lost children. And I will strike down upon thee with great vengeance and furious anger those who attempt to poison and destroy my brothers. And you will know my name is the Lord when I lay my vengeance upon thee. And everybody claps, and I wet my pants a little bit. It was probably the best dramatic performance ever in Los Angeles.
It was the only thing, one of the things you've memorized, and he happened to bring it up, and then you were happened to be sitting right
happened
there.
To be sitting
he
right
happened
there.
To show up. I mean, it was a lot of happening.
The stars aligned, because do you know how many douches in this world have memorized stupid things from movies?
And this all specific of the douchey thing came up, and I am the specific douche who has specifically memorized it, and I happen to be sitting in that seat right in front of the most famous comedian in the world. And so
you're like the douche messiah.
I'm telling you, I was chosen. I was meant to be there.
It was your finest moment.
It which is not saying much, but still, it was pretty amazing.
I don't know what else beats that.
Nothing. Nothing. Are you kidding? I've done nothing of significance except for this. And this really was important. And so I finish, and Dave Chappelle, everyone's clapping, and Dave Chappelle is like, man, this dude's sitting here all night like, I got to do my taxes. And then all of a sudden, Ezekiel 25:17 comes up, and he just comes out of nowhere.
I got to do my taxes. So white people do.
How's the portfolio? Strong?
It's not good. All right. I want to there's been a lot of talk, obviously, about Me Too and Harvey Weinstein being a fat scumbag who, I got to tell you, it kind of seems like a lot of people in Hollywood were complicit in his scumbaggery.
I blame the potted plant.
I don't even get that reference.
I think a couple things. Like, women in this business have been treated like sex objects for a long time, for basically the whole industry, you know, the history of the industry, right? I mean, and it was always this deal they could have made, like sleep with the producer and get a career. And I think a lot of people either happily made that choice or were forced into it. It's good that it's coming to an end, right? Like that deal, I think, is off the table. But yeah, you're right. Like, it seems like that was the status quo until this year.
Is it coming to an end?
It never can. I mean, I think
it's hard to say. I mean, when you have an ugly dude with power offering a young girl who's good looking a job, I mean, it's a story that's as old as time.
The problem is you've got someone with an incredible amount of power who basically has the ability to indiscriminately hand out. How many pretty women are there in Hollywood that could play the pretty woman role? I mean, let's be honest, as women complain,
endless, yeah.
There are not the most complex roles written for women in Hollywood. And so if you've got token good-looking girl as you know, a supporting actress in a role, he can give that to any one of 1,000 good-looking blondes.
Yeah.
And so how does sex not enter into it? I'm not condoning it. I'm just saying I don't know how you police that.
It's hard because there are, I mean, kind of as you're saying, there are 1,000 qualified people. I mean, I wonder how many waiters go to a Keanu Reeves movie and are like, Jesus, I could have done that better. Like,
how many podcasts have I listened to that are highly ranked on iTunes? And I'm just like, this is unlistenable. Our show is 10% more listenable than this garbage.
Oh, at least maybe 11. But I mean, I think that's the difficulty is, a lot of these casting decisions, I think, are really arbitrary. There are 1,000 people who are excited and eager to do the job, and all of this power is instilled in these men who clearly let that power go to their head. And I don't think it's not simple enough to just say Harvey Weinstein is a scumbag. I think there is a system of misogyny and abuse that has been perpetuated for 100 years. And the reason I ask if you think it's starting to change, I hope it is, but I'm curious, in your career, have you ever witnessed anything like this or heard about anything like it that you've experienced?
No, I've never. I mean, the crowds I'm running in are like,
they're writer types.
I have cast before, you know, when you cast for things, it's a really strange process. I mean, people come in, they read something for like 5 minutes. They come in, you know, then they leave and you're sort of reacting based on how it felt to you in the moment. Like, did it feel like the part in your head? I mean, it's really arbitrary.
Do you proposition the women at the casting couch or after?
Yeah, we usually meet in the van, like around the corner, and we're like, hey, you were good. Do you really want this role? I mean, you got to assume that's how it used to go down. Like,
for
people
sure.
Just like, it was pretty cut and dry. But you also hear stories of like everyone's desk had lines in it from all the cocaine they used to do and the Quaaluden. And like, that shit was like public for the 80s and 90s, a lot of it. So I think you'll sort of tamp this down by hiring more female executives and having different kinds of people in those jobs that wouldn't do something like this. I think even directors, it's been 99% men. So if you put more women in those roles, you're not going to have as much of that stuff. You know, I don't know. It's all shifting.
There are a bunch of studies that I've been reading that women in the workplace are the hardest on other women. Women who have female bosses get fewer promotions than women who have male bosses. And so it's really a systemic problem. And I think that's
what
compounded.
Do you mean by everyone says systemic? I don't know what that means. Like, does somebody organize a system?
No, systemic meaning it doesn't have a single simple solution. So getting rid of a Harvey Weinstein doesn't solve the problem. It's like Connor's full body scabies. If you were to surgically remove one scabie, it doesn't solve the problem. It's systemic. He is scabies.
And sometimes even when you try to treat the scabies, you end up creating another problem like George Foreman butt or full body acne.
Or that voice. What do you got?
or the Janis Joplin
voice. Have you been chain smoking Marlboro?
I'm not sure
Reds?
What happened there.
Well, and then also I find a particular problem in Hollywood when dealing with these types of issues, because it's not like a workplace where in a regular workplace, you have absolutely no authority to comment on the way a woman looks at all. And that's an easy line to draw. What do you do in a situation where you're on a modeling set and women are supposed to be naked. How does that, I mean, I was on a set.
You just keep your, you act professional. I mean, you don't bring your sexuality into it because it's a job. I mean, it sounds simple, but there's a way to treat a naked woman and there's a way to treat a naked woman incorrectly on a job. I mean, yeah, there's a lot of, I've shot comedy scenarios where someone's giving a blowjob or a girl's topless, getting fucked from behind. Like it's all for some sort of setup to a joke. And it's a little awkward, right? Because you have to sort of be like, okay, now do it like this. You just have to act professional with respect. I mean, it's pretty obvious when you're there.
For sure.
Before you go, I want to talk movies because I never get to talk movies with John because, as I mentioned, he hasn't watched one. The other night, I was watching a modern day classic, about 20 years old now. It's called Face Off. And I learned a lot watching it again. I hadn't seen it since it came out when I was about 15. I learned that if you just cut a perimeter around your face, that you can just rip your face off, like nothing's connecting it, which is exciting. I kind of want to try that at home.
True.
Also learned that Nicolas Cage was rightfully the go-to action star of the 90s. And I was reminded, and this is more of a serious point, that John Woo is garbage. I mean, this is my gripe. Why, when there are so many talented people out there, are John Woo and Michael Bay still making movies? And now, Dominic, I don't want to get you preemptively fired from the Michael Bay movie that you were trying out for, so I will make this less personalized. If I have to see another slow motion shot of a goddamn pigeon flying through a doorway while Nicolas Cage walks with his jacket open, I'm gonna goddamn barf in my hands.
I think those movies probably made a shitload of money.
Well, I rented it other night, so it just made another $2.99.
Yeah. Isn't your review of the movie Face Off maybe 19 years late?
No, this is relevant.
I was unaware when we started the podcast today that Connor was like, near the end of the show, was going to be like, I would like to review a movie that came out 20 years ago that no one has seen.
Just because you haven't seen it, because you don't watch movies.
Let me blend this together for everybody.
Please.
Because I'm a television writer, and so part of what I do is try to develop new shows and sell them. So every year I'm developing a couple new projects and trying to move those along. There was a story I saw on Reddit the other day. It was a news article about a soldier who got blown up by an IED. His dick was essentially like exploded, and they were performing a dick transplant. They took a penis cadaver, put it on this soldier's new body. So he's got a new penis that used to be somebody else's, but they wouldn't put in the testicles because now he would be sporting some other guy's sperm. And so if he had a kid, it wasn't, you know, the other guy was dead. So he hadn't given consent to have kids, which is pretty interesting.
That is fascinating.
But that was the story. So the face off of it all now is, what happens when you have another man's penis? Do you still want to sleep with the same, I don't know, whoever's? So that's,
and do you get to choose it? Because right away I'm like,
well, this is where the writing would come in, right? So that's the story you read. So you as a writer go, I'm going to option this.
Can I choose the ethnicity? Because I have some general stereotypes about the different ethnicities and where I would choose my genitals.
There's a donor list, and the list is, you know, you're going to take, you either get no dick or what's first on the list.
That's a tough one. That's a tough one. Because there's some glory in saying I was blown up by an IED. I have no genitals, versus I have a transplant that is underwhelming.
I just wonder if they show you the list of the donors' names.
And, I know and, that we have to be careful here.
If the name is like Connor, just go, nope, I'm good. I'm going to sit this one out. But if it comes up as Darnell, yeah, I'll take that one.
No, you know what? There's actually something. This is fascinating, and this might be another.
So this would be a good way to at least mine a TV show idea or a story idea. I don't know. That's a fascinating hook.
Speaking of not putting the testicles of the old man on there because they would produce a sperm with his DNA, I read an absolutely fascinating story that is similar to this. And that is, now that we have these, as we talked about earlier, the Ancestry.com, the 23andMe, what happened is the guy had a child with his wife, and something happened, whether it was a divorce or something came up, a genetic thing where they had to do genetic testing. And the child came back as not being the child of the father, but being the child of a brother of the father, because brothers share a certain amount of DNA. And the guy goes, that's impossible. The husband goes, that's impossible. I'm an only child. And the doctors were absolutely stumped. They said, they reran the tests and everything, and they said, no, this is absolutely not your child. It is your brother's child. And he goes, again, I don't have a brother. And they did more and more research, and they tested his sperm. Here's what happened, and this is absolutely fascinating to me. In utero, very frequently, you can have divisions of the, I don't know if zygote or cell or whatever the term is.
I think
the
it's
embryo.
Called jizz. Yeah.
And so what happened is, in utero, he had a twin. He had a twin brother in utero that didn't survive, and the body reabsorbed it. But for whatever reason, some of the DNA of that twin was absorbed into his body. And this is all absolutely serious. None of this is a joke. Up to 15% of that man's sperm is the sperm of his in utero twin brother that never lived.
So on Maury Povich, is he not the father?
That is a good, good question. But man, I found that absolutely fascinating.
You need to get that sound effect.
The only reason that they know about this is because of the odd scenario that played out. And so for all I know, my children, I mean, we don't know how often this happens. You don't know how often, I mean, what percentage of my sperm is 100% my DNA. I don't know. So my children could be my in utero parasitic twins children.
God, if they're lucky. What's amazing is that that means the in utero parasitic twin who sort of died in utero also went through puberty.
Yes, it's just strange. It's almost like Dominic briefly mentioned CRISPR, and I don't know if people saw the 60-minute story on CRISPR or know anything about what that is, but it's kind of this way that bacteria can splice sections of DNA, and it's almost like the DNA of the twin brother was somehow spliced into various aspects or absorbed. I mean, sometimes these people will find, they'll have operations, and they'll find a twin, an actual semi-developed twin inside of a body cavity of a person that they didn't know was there. I mean, this kind of stuff happens. It's kind of like a genetic dumpster, like a leftover stuff. Are there any Reddits for this?
I'm sure there are. I haven't. I'm going to look into those stories because it's a pretty fascinating topic. I need a new topic for tomorrow's pods. Maybe that's a good one.
I actually, I know, Dominic, I know you've got kind of a hard stop, and I had a number of things that I want to talk about, a number of things on Reddit. So maybe we'll have you back and discuss some more stuff on Reddit.
That'd be great. This was fun, guys. Thanks for having me on.
Yeah, thank you for joining, and I'm glad we got to hear about Connor's A Moment of Glory with Dave Chappelle.
That was the whole reason I came on, right?
God, I'm so glad you brought that up. That was really my sole objective, was to try to get Dominic to tell that story so that I didn't have to bring it up.
So one of the things I like to do as we end the show is look back on what we learned today, and typically it's completely useless stuff. So what did we cover today? We covered free bleeding,
mm-hmm.
gym nudity.
Manny from Modern Family.
Manny's puberty growth spurt. Why a 24-hour should not be called a 24-hour if it's really only open 12 hours.
God, it drives me crazy.
The world of subreddits and how you can have, was it near vagina?
Mildly vagina.
Mildly vagina.
How to sell a TV show.
We again touched on Connor's scabies and basically talked about really cool Hollywood stuff.
Yeah, and also the reasons why Face Off is a modern day classic.
That's right. We should get John Woo on.
Oh, yeah, that'll happen.
Is he still alive?
All right, everybody. Thanks for being with us for this episode of Wild Card. Again, I want to thank our guest, Dominic Russo. You can get back to all your Hollywood things and your power lunches. We will be back with another episode of Wild Card next week.
Thanks for listening to Wild Card. See live podcasts and pics from the show on Instagram and Facebook, or visit us online at wildcardshow.com.